Good morning, everyone. So today I'm going to talk about client-side encryption. And as the topic sounds, it's negative. I don't want to discourage you from using client-side encryption. Rather, I want to give you a cautionary message which will allow you to use client-side encryption better. So I've been analyzing failures in cryptographic softwares and identifying why they are failing often in practice. I can tell you with 100% certainty, encryption is useless unless you know where it lives and how it lives. Let me explain what I mean by this. So 2 years back, researchers found that Western digital disk encryption is completely useless because of numerous bugs in that implementation. They had a very weak RNG and very weak password key derivation function that allowed attackers to easily grab the keys and decrypt the whole disk. And the drone attack, they were able to get at the SSL session keys by exploiting some vulnerabilities in the OpenSSL implementation, and along with servers which supported SSL version 2, which they should not, because SSL version 2 has been broken for a long time. And Apple bug, the simple repeated go-to statement made some code dead and effectively allowed authentication, SSL authentication code to be bypassed, and it made encryption again useless, transport level encryption useless. Remember those backdoors on ScreenOS? One of those backdoors allowed us to see all the VPN encrypted traffic, again made the encryption useless. There are numerous examples in the past that we can talk about for the whole day. The point I want to make here is encryption itself does not make a system secure. So if you look at these failures, we can at least identify a few areas in which encryption failed. Weak key derivation functions, weak random number generators allowed us to get to the keys with minimal effort. And key in memory, especially in mobile devices, are vulnerable to memory scraping attacks. Implementation flaws and design flaws provided shortcuts to the keys. And insecure configurations pointed to already broken protocols. And backdoors are the worst. They provide access to the encryption with little effort. So if you look at these examples, in none of them, encryption algorithm was not broken. Rather, attackers looked at the weakest link, and they were able to grab the keys. So I don't want to give you the wrong message here. If you do the encryption right, it's more than useful. It's in fact makes us safe. That's why we are able to do e-commerce, e-banking, or even use blockchains. And it's no different with client-side encryption. Client-side encryption can fail in any of the ways that I mentioned earlier. And in today's talk, I'm going to talk about a few more new ways in which client-side encryption can fail. The rationale behind talking about these failures is that if you know these failures, you can design your systems in a way you can at least resist these failures or at least fail less often. Let me first try to motivate why we need client-side encryption. In other words, end-to-end encryption in client-server paradigm. So if you look at today's organizations, they mostly access many cloud applications. So this puts their sensitive data outside of organizational perimeter. In fact, the sensitive data exposure has been one of the main threats for modern enterprises. Just to confirm this fact, if you look at Cloud Security Alliance's top threat report, data breaches has been the number one threat for the last several years. So let's step back. Instead of looking at this complex enterprise architecture, we can look at this simple client-server model, which essentially boils down to the simple client where you have users who access services from the server, and your data is stored in the service. So the whole web is built on top of this client-server architecture. Even all the cloud applications, all the storage services, SaaS applications, and whatnot, everything follows this paradigm. And this architecture works because it provides attractive scalability. But the problem here is when there's a data breach or when these the three-letter legal organizations get at your data, users don't have control over it, and their privacy is compromised. One obvious solution is to use encryption here. So what kind of encryption would work here? So one popular kind is data at rest encryption. Most of the cloud service providers and third-party vendors provide this type of encryption. As the name suggests, here the data is encrypted when it is not in use, and also the keys are with the service provider. And when the data is in use, it's decrypted and it's available at the service provider. So it doesn't address the threat model we are looking at here. The other popular kind of encryption pattern is data in motion encryption, or the transport layer encryption, where it prevents man-in-the-middle attacks. And as you can see, it doesn't prevent the threats we are talking about. So what we really need is something that will encrypt the data at the client side and also keep the keys at the client side. That's what client-side encryption is all about. So idea is quite simple. Before the data goes from client devices, if it is in an organization, it will probably a proxy. Before it leaves the proxy, it will get encrypted, and the keys will stay inside the proxy, and the server will only see the encrypted data. So, and this is good. When there's a data breach, users' privacy is not compromised, and when three-letter organizations try to access their data, they won't be able to because it's all encrypted. But there is one big problem here, namely functionality. When you encrypt this data at the client side, encryption by definition makes data useless. So now when we want to go do certain server-side functionality like deduplication, searching, it fails to work. So what can we do here? The problem we are dealing here is we want to hide the data from the server, and at the same time, we want to allow certain functionality on top of that data. There are mainly two approaches cryptographers have been looking into. I'll first talk about the first class of approach people are using, namely computing of encrypted data. In this camp, the researchers asked the question, can we perform certain operation on top of encrypted data without decrypting it? And these schemes are broadly called homomorphic encryption schemes. As you know, non-deterministic encryption schemes, by default, you can't do any operation on top of that. And the other generally available homomorphic encryption schemes are singly homomorphic, meaning you can either do additions or multiplications, not both, like Paley encryption and Elgamal encryption. But they are not suitable for doing general purpose computation. What we really need is fully homomorphic encryption schemes, where you can do any type of operation on top of encrypted data without decrypting. Since 2009, that's when Gentry introduced the first fully homomorphic encryption using lattice-based cryptography, there has been numerous improvements that allowed us to do fully homomorphic encryption, but we are still quite not there to use it in our systems, especially where we want high response, where responsiveness is very important. So for the application we are talking about, it doesn't work as well. For batch processing systems or where the responsiveness is not very critical, you might still use fully homomorphic encryption schemes, the third generation ones. So we looked at the homomorphic encryption schemes. They don't work. The other option is to use this, what is called property preserving encryption schemes. The idea here is, how can we encrypt data in a way that allows us to preserve some properties? So I'm going to talk about three popular property preserving encryption schemes that's been used both in academia as well as in industry, and then talk about what kind of security guarantees they provide when you put them into real systems. So the first type is deterministic encryption. As the name tells, when you encrypt the same plain text twice with the same key, you will always end up with the same ciphertext. So this allows us to efficiently do equality searches on top of the data. And the second type of PPE scheme is called searchable encryption. This allows you to do encrypted searches over encrypted documents. The document encrypts the plain text by keyword, and then you can make encrypted keyword search queries on top of that one. And the third scheme is called order preserving encryption scheme. The idea here is, as the name suggests, when you encrypt numerical data, it will preserve the order here. As you can see, it's in the increasing order. After you encrypt it, it keeps that increasing order. This allows you to do inequality queries on top of data. And from these three encryption schemes, the strongest one is searchable encryption, and after that deterministic, and order preserving encryption is quite weak because it leaks a lot of information. So these are not just academic encryption schemes, even though you may not have heard about them much, because we currently use mostly AES, RSA, or these popular symmetric and asymmetric encryption schemes. They are in fact used in many of these startups as well as in academic projects. So these are some of the selected startups and some established companies which are already using these types of encryption schemes to provide this type of functionality. You can find companies in all three spaces, and you have even big companies like SAP which are providing these types of encryption schemes. And one thing to note here is millions of VC funding has been poured into this system, identifying the importance of protecting our systems from data breaches and unauthorized accesses. So let me point you to a few products which uses this PPE scheme. I would like to call them SOPETs, systems built on top of property preserving encryption schemes. And cloud access security brokers, when they do encryption, they use these PPE schemes. Cloud encryption gateways, it's a subset of cloud access security brokers. They use PPE scheme to do encryption. And these encrypted databases and encrypted storages, they use property preserving encryption to encrypt and upload it to these databases or even to cloud storages like Dropbox, Box, and the other cloud storage services. So now we saw where it's used and who is using it and what kind of techniques we have. Now I would like to go into details to see what kind of security guarantees they provide. And a key message I want to give you in this talk is, if you don't take some cautionary steps, it might leak a lot of information and it could end up being encryption is being useless. So let me show you some examples. Before we talk about security of this one, we need to have a clear threat model. The power of the adversaries, what the adversary can do. So if you look at our established system, we have established threat models for those systems. But when it comes to SOPETs, we Right now, we don't have established threat models. I strung together three threat models based on recent research works, which we are going to use as examples to talk about security here. So the first model is called snapshot passive adversary. The idea here is these adversaries can break into your SOAP and grab the snapshot of data and do attack offline. And passive persistent passive adversaries, they continuously monitor your systems and access patterns and gather data from your systems for a long time and try to attack at your system. And the active adversaries are the worst. They can do all these passive adversaries can do, plus malicious activities and interfere with all the activities. So under these three threat models, I want to show you that this current SOAP only protects, even if you are very careful, it will protect only against snapshot passive threat model, and it won't protect your systems against persistent passive adversaries. Before I show you that, I want to show you three concrete examples of these SOAP. The first one I want to show you is relational databases, encrypted relational databases. There are already products available in the market which use this technique. For example, Microsoft Always Encrypted uses property preserving encryption. They actually use two types of encryption, either deterministic encryption or randomized encryption. And users have the flexibility to tell which type of encryption they want to use, and then the client library will automatically encrypt and decrypt when it goes into the cloud and when it comes out of the cloud. So the idea here is when it's stored in the cloud, those annotated fields will be encrypted. When user queries the database, when they get the query back, the client library will automatically decrypt it and show it to the user. It's transparent to the user. So the second example is another encrypted database. It's in the NoSQL space. And this is an experimental project done on Google BigQuery. It's very similar to the previous example. Only difference here is instead of doing single encryption, they use what is called onion encryption. These data are encrypted using multiple layers of encryption to provide better security. So if the data is not in use, you can keep the encryption in randomized encryption, which provides semantic security. And when the system is in use, they peel these onions and come to a steady state and then do the query processing. And this onion-based encryption was introduced by some MIT researchers in 2011 in the database called CryptDB. So the third example I want to show you is you can build even encrypted web applications. So this is an experimental platform built by MIT researchers called Myla. So they built this encrypted web application platform on top of this popular JavaScript-based web application platform called Meteor. The idea here is you can port any regular Meteor application by annotating what type of encryption you want to use and which fields. If you simply annotate it, it will automatically encrypt it in the server. And they use something called principal graph to identify which user should get to which type of encryption. And there is a browser plugin which transparently handles the keys. So keys will never leave the browser, and it will stay in the browser. And the Meteor web application platform will not see your plain text data. So now we looked at three examples, and I want to show you what kind of attacks we can do based on the three threat models I presented earlier. So the first one is, the weakest one is the snapshot passive adversary. Remember, they break into your system, they take a snapshot out of your system and try to analyze this data and infer encrypted data. So I want to show you a few examples which researchers have used to break these systems. The first one is, in this type of property preserving encryption schemes, if you notice, we don't encrypt all the fields. That's mainly because of functionality reasons as well as performance reasons. But there's a danger in it. When you don't encrypt all these fields, that will allow attackers to infer data about the encrypted data from unencrypted data. Remember this popular de-anonymization attack? They were able to uniquely identify everyone using three simple attributes. Similarly, attackers were able to, like as mentioned in this paper, attackers were able to recover data from these databases simply by looking at the plain text data, which is not encrypted. The second type of attack I want to talk about is on deterministic encryption. Deterministic encryption provides semantic security only if you use it on top of unique fields. If you try to encrypt non-unique fields, it will leak information about the encrypted data. So in the same paper, attackers show how to combine these deterministically encrypted non-unique values with some auxiliary data and try to recover information from that one. They actually showed it on top of a encrypted patient database. They were able to recover more than 60% of patient attributes from these deterministically encrypted non-unique fields. And order preserving encryption is more damaging. If you use order preserving encryption on dense fields where you have data for most of the domain values, researchers again have shown that you can do inference attacks where you can combine auxiliary information and then sort this information in a way that reveals the information encrypted. And they were able to recover about 80% of patient attributes which are encrypted using order preserving encryption. And another attack that hasn't been shown here is based on metadata. There's this application called Encrypted Chat. It encrypts all the chat messages, but researchers were able to look at the metadata, what type of chat group names and how the principals interact. Based on those metadata, they were able to recover most of these chat messages. So if you look at these real systems, most of the time, people don't consider about the metadata. They consider metadata as outside of their threat model. But in a real system, if you exclude metadata from your system, that can lead to inference attacks as well. And persistent passive attackers, they continuously monitor your system and monitor your access patterns and learn information from that one to decrypt your data. And last year, there was a paper in CCS. They were showing how to identify a group patients based on the access pattern. They were able to group all the patients into different clusters, simply watching the access patterns, even though everything in the system is encrypted using these property preserving encryption techniques. And active adversaries. None of these systems can protect against active adversaries. They all were broken because these systems are designed in a way it won't come to the steady state. For example, if you take the onion encryption, if an active adversary can get into the system, they can peel all the onions and come to the lowest level, which is the weakest encryption you can have. And you can do all kinds of inference attacks with the weakest encryption you have. So let me summarize some of the key points about these systems. This is one important thing, metadata. We often neglect about metadata. When we design these kind of systems, we should pay more attention to this metadata. In order to make systems more secure, we should try to hide as much metadata as possible. And it's a very hard problem because metadata is what glues the systems together. And if you try to add encryption on top of an existing system, it's a very hard problem to solve. At least when we build new systems, we can design our system to hide metadata at least. And the second point I want to make is you can infer information about encrypted data from non-encrypted data, just like the Microsoft Always Encrypted example I've showed you. So as a good practice, we should try to encrypt as much information as possible. If you encrypt more, we prevent the attackers from getting the signal what is important and what is not important. The third one is it's a very hard problem to solve as well. These access patterns, when you have persistent passive adversaries, they can continuously monitor your system and identify the access patterns to recover encrypted data. And none of these SOAPs protects against this one. You need different kind of techniques to protect against access patterns. Right now, there are no practical schemes that allow you to protect your systems against access pattern. In research, we have something called oblivious RAMs. They hide all these access patterns. But the problem is they are not very practical, and they are not quite efficient to use in real systems yet. And the last point I want to make is if you don't use this property preserving encryption on right set of data, you might leak a lot of information. For example, if you use deterministic encryption on non-unique fields, that leaks information. And if you use order preserving encryption on top of very dense fields, it leaks a lot of information as well. So you have to be cautious about on what field you are applying what type of property preserving encryption scheme. So if you don't follow these guidelines, your SOAPet might not be as secure as you might think. They're most likely to protect against snapshot passive adversaries only. So what can we do about the other adversaries? Persistent passive adversaries and active adversaries. Security doesn't work in isolation. Just because you have encryption, you can't assume that your system is going to be secure against all the threats. So we need to use additional mechanisms to make sure that our systems are secure against other threats as well. So I want to summarize all the things I talked about into one slide and where you can apply it in your organization. You might be a developer, or you might be a user of these SOAPs, or you might be someone who's looking into these encryption algorithms. The first thing you can do is to identify what kind of encryption techniques you are using in your organization. Depending on the type of encryption scheme you are using, it might provide different security guarantees. It's good to have, the first thing to defend against something is to identify what you have. And as I mentioned earlier, there is no replacement for defense in depth. Just because you encrypt something, it doesn't mean secure. We need to make sure that we have additional mechanism to make it harder for attackers to come at our data. And again, I want to reiterate, metadata, even though we don't consider it in our threat models these days, we should, because metadata can lead to inferring about encrypted data. And use more encryption. It's not just use it more, if we can make it transparent, for example, even in end-to-end encryption in peer-to-peer applications like Signal, why is it becoming popular? It's used everywhere and it's transparent to users. If you make encryption transparent to users, everyone will use it. And we need to think about designing these systems against the perceived threats. If you don't identify all the possible threats, and if you design that system and put it into practice, it will fail. And at the same time, we need to have TPE schemes which leaks less information. There are ongoing research in this area where people look into new encryption schemes which leaks the minimal amount of information. For example, order preserving encryption, there are new research which try to come up with schemes which only leaks the order, nothing else. And one last side, I would like to leave you with this message. Encryption doesn't equal secure. You need to take care of other facts to make your system secure. I'll leave you to read that one offline. And with that, I would like to conclude my talk. If you have any questions, I would like to answer. Can you come out?
Hello. So you talked about transparency to users. What about application developers who are trying to inject encryption as part of the software development lifecycle? What sort of mechanisms are being researched on or available to kind of make encryption integration into the code also very transparent? I mean, there are obviously some encryption libraries that developers have to explicitly code to, which creates a lot of barriers in terms of software development lifecycle, you know, the time that it takes and all that stuff. So if you can comment on that.
Yeah, so that's a good question. Actually, right now, to tell the least, we don't have an established set of libraries which we can use for even for property preserving encryption, like RSA or AES. That's one difficulty developers face. And the other one is there is no right set of guidelines to which set of encryption to use, which sets of data. There is some improvement. For example, this MyLab platform, they try to make it easy for developers by just simply using annotation on top of the data. That makes the developer's life easier. They don't need to know about anything about the encryption schemes. They don't need to know about what type they need to use. If they just say what they want to encrypt it, it will figure out automatically depending on the data and the type of the data, it will figure out the encryption schemes. But there is a lot to do in that area to make it easier for developers. I wish we have well-established set of libraries in the first place. Right now, if you look at GitHub, you will see here and there are libraries for property preserving, order preserving encryption, and for searchable encryption, but nothing established yet.
Thank you.
I have a question about, have you considered or have you done any research in layering encryption? Layering encryption.
What's that?
Layering encryption, encryption over encryption.
The, like the one, that onion encryption?
I'm saying if you put two or three different types of encryption together, mm-hmm. actually having three separate keys and different types, have you done that?
So you keep it separately?
The data is encrypted three times.
Okay.
Yeah, it's the onion is what
so
you call
the onion.
So if
you use three different keys, it's I don't see any security issues with that.
Okay, is that what you meant by encryption more?
Oh no, so what I meant by here is with these property preserving encryption techniques, people try to encrypt only more sensitive data, uh-huh. not realizing that if you keep this non-sensitive data, can lead to infer these sensitive okay. data. So what I meant is you should encrypt the non-sensitive data as well.
That goes back to your metadata discussion and how they can get to the other data.
Yeah, metadata is another area where metadata is the glue. For example, if you have chat application, metadata would be chat group names, how many users are connected to that chat group and how they are interacting, those kind of information.
Okay.
Even that should be hidden from the users. And in a relational database, a metadata may be the table names and the table fields.
Exactly.
Those should be even encrypted as well.
All right, thank you.
All right.
So yeah, one question. We have a lot of, like, we use things like AES or RSA because they've been looked at a lot and we have good confidence nobody found any weakness in it. Did you look into the, like, the security of the algorithms, like the order preserving algorithm that you use, how they compare to things like AES in terms of, the classical attacks on crypto, crypto-like brute force attacks or others. Do they, are they comparable? Because usually you hear, do you encrypt A? Yes, because that's what everyone knows. Now you use new algorithms, and typically what you say, don't use unproven algorithms. Mm-hmm. So how do they compare?
These algorithms are still in its infancy, and I would say searchable encryption, it provides guarantees similar to semantic security we have with AES and RSA, but order preserving encryption is still not. It's in make and break cycle, and even in the last year in the security conference, there were papers talking about how to break this system and come up with a better system. It will take some more time, I guess, to have established standard on order preserving encryption.
Okay, thank you.
You probably already have answered that, but just to be more specific, I was wondering what is the acceptance of these PPE algorithms by the government standards like Common Criteria or the NIST?
That's again a good question. I think right now we don't have any established standards. So, okay. But industry has been using it for some time, and it seems companies are willing to take a risk and use this as well. But at the same time, they need to be cautious about what they are getting as well. Just because you encrypt with some kind of encryption scheme, it doesn't mean secure. To make things worse, sometimes, I don't want to pick names here, they say they do prefix encryption. When you do partial encryption, there are numerous work showing that you can get at the data if you don't do complete encryption. And if you hide only partial information, the unhidden information can be used to infer information from the other one. So we need to, especially vendors should make clear what kind of security guarantees they provide for their users when they provide these custom encryption schemes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So going back to that slide where there was a query and it said, select all where role maybe equals manager, right? And then you encrypted that so that it wasn't visible what exactly the query contained. there was a SQL query that had manager as part of it and it became encrypted and then...
This one?
Yeah, so, I mean, what stops somebody from creating a glorified rainbow table for all the things you might want to find?
Sorry?
What stops somebody from creating, say, a glorified rainbow table to try and find all the different search strings that you may want to look for and kind of replacing?
So they need to have the key to create those queries. If they have the key, they can do it.
No, but I mean, if you created a brute force list of a lot of possible combinations and you can search for those, you're going to find them, right?
So this... Even though I show a very toyed example here, it's going to be a very, the usually when you do order preserving encryption, the domain is going to be very large, and the rainbow table will be very big as well.
Okay. So that's,
that will right. make it harder for them to attack on.
Okay, fair enough, thanks.
Any more questions? Thank you, everyone.